All right, it's 135 The Beat, Miami Suit Up 1 for Hip Hop, R&B, and The Breakfast Club. Pop and Key for People Matter in the building. Very special guest, Mr. Nick Cannon. How are you, sir?
Pop and Key, what's good, my G?
I'm so blessed, man. I appreciate the opportunity to have you in here and get to chop it up with you, brother.
Come on, man. The pleasure's all mine.
You know, like, coming up, I've always admired key people in the industry. I admired Diddy.
Yeah.
Because he did so much.
Still doing it.
Right. But I admire you for the same reason. How do you do so many things? Like, if you have your list, it's like actor, comedian.
Yeah.
You endorse all these different things. You host.
Gentlemen of leisure.
Artist, like,
I get it in.
I know, but usually a person's great at one or two things or good at maybe one or two things. How are you good at all of these things, man?
I just think, really, I think of it as one job, and you got to keep cooking while the pot is hot. But it's like, to me, I just want to be the best entertainer. I wake up every day and I get to be creative. That's my job. That's a blessing. So I go hard at it. You know what I mean? And I got to keep my foot on their neck. So whether it's TV, movies, music, comedy, endorsements, like products, like all of that. Like, I feel like, yo, you know, you ever get an opportunity, like, man, I can't believe they let me up in here. I'm gonna get everything I can get. You know what I mean? Like, I'm in here rioting, like, just grabbing stuff off the racks. Like, I'm gonna get as much as I can, because they don't give brothers like us too many opportunities. So when we get in there, we gotta shake up the room.
I love it. I love that attitude too. What would you credit to really breaking you out? What was the platform that really bust Nick Cannon?
Interestingly enough, comedy back in the day. I was probably the youngest staff writer in television history. I was doing that for Nickelodeon when I was like 16, 17 years old, just writing, doing the comedy warm-ups and everything. And then from there, people saw I was this young kid that was really getting to it. And then right. I got all of the other opportunities from music, TV, and movies off of that.
I'm still fascinated about all this stuff that you do. How do you, like, prioritize, or how do you, like, how do you put it all together?
I got tunnel vision, so like whatever's in front of me is like, that's what I conquer, and then like you stay focused on that till you get it done, and then you slide it off. I think that's the best way, just time management more than anything, keeping a solid team around you to help you, and knowing everybody on your team's strengths.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because then that allows me to kind of maneuver and be creative. Because at the end of the day, I'm a creative. I'm probably not the best when it comes to like logistics and follow through and all that. Mm-hmm. Like, I just do what's on my heart in the moment, and then you surround yourself, you hire the best people. You know what I mean? Like, that's what they say. Like, the smartest dude in the room knows that he got to hire people smarter than him.
That's what's up.
Yeah.
Which one of your favorites out of all the crafts and different things that
Say music, realistically. It's the one I've been doing the longest. It's the one that's my passion. It's the one I would pay to do. You know what I mean? It's mm-hmm. the one that, like, and it's really my true escape. Like, I live in the studio, literally. Like, shower, eat, like, everything in the studio. And, like, I could sit in front of my piano for 4 hours and be like, and just right there, like, just because you get it allows you to escape but still emote all at the same time. So music is definitely that.
Talking about the music, what direction are you in with the music right now?
Right now, we turning up. I mean, like, we got a joint out there that's going crazy with Fat Joe and Luke Nasty. We shot the video in Miami, you know. It got that Surface Happy sample, so it's like, it's
yes.
feel good. The weather's right. It's perfect for spring break. It's perfect for summertime. So we on that. We having a good time. But the overall project is like, it's called Model Music, and I just approached it on the way that like Quincy Jones would approach a project, or Dr. Dre approached it, as just like the producer and the curator, bringing established artists as well as new artists together and just putting out a good body of work.
That's dope. Who are some people that you're looking at right now?
Everybody from Yo Gotti, Black Youngster, like I said, we got the joint with Quavo, Jeremiah on there, some new cast, a guy out of Chicago by the name of Ty Money, young lady by the name of Natalie Nicole, who's fire. It's a movie, a kid from Atlanta, like, so it's new and young. Me and Zaytoven got this new artist named Jeff that's ridiculous, like,
right.
So all of them are on the project. But again, like I said, we got joints like Only You with Luke Nasty and Fat Joe that
right.
are just dudes that's already killing the radio right now. So we putting it all together in a big way.
They are killing the radio, those two, as a matter of fact.
Yeah.
So how soon are we going to get the complete
The complete body of work will be out by end of spring. Okay. But I think, like, we've been rolling it out. Like I said, like, we got the joint Motivation out there right now, Dream Girls out there right now, yes. Only You. So, like, we only got a few more to go to where the whole project is definitely, you're going to hear the whole joint. But, like, it's definitely one of those ones where people say, oh, wow, I didn't see this one coming from Nick. And that's kind of what we do at Ncredible. That's the company where we just want to put it out there in a way to where I want to let other people's talent shine. You know what I mean? Like, I kind of play the back. I kind of get my ditty on a little bit. But you know, when I need to step up to the mic and do what I need to do, just to let everybody know it's there.
I mean, you are so well respected in the industry.
Thank you, man.
On so many levels. What pisses you off?
Ah, man, I don't really get too emotional about much. You know what I mean? Because I know, like, this game, it's a cycle to it. You know what I mean? But I would always say things that aren't respected, like, off balance pisses me off. You know what I mean? Like, where things are overhyped.
Right.
It ain't really what it all cracked up to be. And it's stuff that don't get enough light and things shined on it. So that's whether it's in my own career and others' careers too. And that's why, as a curator, as somebody who gives people opportunities, I want to make sure all those people are working as hard as they can for them opportunities, and that they get the respect to show, like, how much they've been working for. But anytime something's overhyped, and a lot of times, because we got disposable content right now.
Right.
We're in the age of disposable content. So the hottest thing in the world could just be some kid in his bedroom mumbling. You know what I mean? Like, and I ain't knocking that.
Right.
But then when there's so much great stuff that doesn't get to shine, like, yes, that's a little frustrating. But I salute when things go right for the people who've really been working hard, like a Cardi B. Like, she deserves everything she gets. She's embracing everything, you know, at the moment. And it's just like she living her best life.
Right.
Like, that's you love to see people like that win. But a lot of times it's a lot of people who take this industry for granted, not knowing how hard it is for artists to actually get in there and get it. And just because they that kid at that moment, or they got followers, or one of the Kardashians Snapchatted their record,
now they
out of here. Like, to me, those are the cheat codes. I ain't against cheat codes, but at least understand and embrace what you got going.
I love it. Do you think that's a generational thing? You think it's like,
it
you
is,
know?
But I'm not mad at it. Like, I love what the young people are doing in a big way. I just think sometimes it's our job to remind them how to be grateful, you know what I mean, for humanity. And that's even to take it outside of music and entertainment for a second. Like, I think right now we've been desensitized to humanity. And, you know, and we don't want to start talking about the problems until there's a tragic event. Ultimately, if we recognize that it starts at the home first, and that if we really, like, people got to show the value of life, man, the value of opportunity, the value of energy. So that's the type of stuff, like, I'll be trying to put forth. Like, I don't ever want to get too preachy or stuff, but sometimes we be moving so fast that we forget about all of the things that really matter in life, man. So I just be trying to have those soulful conversations with people sometimes.
No, I love it. Do you think, I listen to your comedy, do you think the comedy plays as an outlet for you?
Yeah, you know, well, you know what, that's the thing where I get to say whatever the hell I want to say, you know what I mean? And I'm a very outspoken dude, and like, and then I take time to try to educate, you know what I mean? So it's more of an edutainment type of process. I learned a lot from Dick Gregory before he passed away, you know, God rest his soul. But I think he told me, like, the duty of what a comedian is isn't just to make people laugh, it's to make them think. And to be able to do that and to really to hold that mirror up to society, that's kind of what I do when I'm on the stage doing that. Because, you know, I could say stuff that, you know, I wouldn't be able to get away with if we were just talking in this interview. So that's the beauty of the freedom of being a comic.
Yeah, because I see I get to see a different side of you when you do the comedy.
Yeah, that's what's up.
And you'll even talk about, like, your personal stuff.
Oh, 100%. It's therapeutic by any means. I mean, I've talked about everything from getting married to Mariah, having kids, getting divorced, all of that stuff. Like, that's a place where I can be like, look, I'm going to tell you my side of the story.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's going to be entertaining. I'm going to make you laugh. I'm going to tell you those decisions. You know, me and Kevin Hart talk about it quite often too, to where it's like, this is a place, like, ain't nobody perfect, you know what I mean? But at least we're blessed with this opportunity to be like, yeah, I messed up on that. I should have never did that. Like, and you know, even with him out on his tour right now, it makes for great material, but it humanizes all of us.
Yeah.
So, like, that's the beauty of the stage right there.
I love it. So Mariah's coming back out with a project.
How do you feel
about that?
I just talked to her yesterday. She was telling me she got mad songs completed and she ready to go. So
that's beautiful, man.
Man, she's an icon. Like you,
of course,
we don't get too many to be in the presence of too many living legends, and she's been doing it just
and
as
she's
long.
Definitely
yeah, she's probably one of the few greats that we still got walking among us. So like we gotta embrace that. We gotta embrace it. Don't let that just go by like it's just another artist dropping an album.
All right. We know you got the music coming out.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. What else? This is Nick Cannon have coming up.
You know, we got movies coming. Me and Chris Brown got a joint we just finished.
Oh,
that's going to be crazy. Yeah, called She Ball. A couple other things. But mainly, I'm focused on this music right now. I'm trying to go chase this music
bag.
I see that.
You real focused on that.
Yeah, real talk.
That's what's up. So you said to me earlier when we were talking off air, you were saying that with this album you got coming out, you really stretched in both directions. You involved the younger audience. I mean,
the newer artists and everything. I'm trying to get my Quincy Jones on this. Real talk. I mean, I talk to Quincy a lot, and he's like one of my mentors. And he's like, just as much as you respect the older established artists, you got to give that same respect and love to the new up and comings. And like, that's my job right now as a curator and somebody for the culture. I give people opportunities. You know what I mean? I want to see these new stars shine. People don't know, like, you know, artists like H.E.R. and Kehlani. Like, those are people I discovered, and now they out here, you know, killing the game.
It's crazy. So, but you've done a lot of that, because even with that, even with Wildin' Out, like, you put a lot of people on,
Saturday Night Live, just be standing outside my Wildin' Out door, just taking my cast and putting them on the show.
Right.
Yeah, so about that, and then obviously, you know, a lot of the world wouldn't even know who Cat Williams is, and, you know, a lot of people seen Kevin Hart for the first time, D-Ray Davis, Afion Crockett, all these people started with me, but I don't take credit for it, because their talent is tremendous, but it's just like, if I could be that platform or that portal to give people that shine, that's the same way we do with the music.
I love it, man. Yeah. I love it, man. So you said we could look forward to your project coming up.
Yeah, model music. It's perfect for Miami. You know what I mean? Because everybody know I love models, and Miami has a lot of them.
Yeah.
So I was like, you know, when it started at Fashion Week, I was catching the vibe. I was listening to all the music. I was like, yo, I want that to be my music. So I titled this project Ncredible Gang, Model Music. We get into it.
Besides all of the different things that you've already accomplished.
Right.
Is there something that you still have your eye on that you would like to accomplish or see?
To be honest, like my goal as a philanthropist, you know what I mean? A humanitarian. I think once you make a certain amount of money, you realize that money doesn't even really have value in that sense. You know what I mean? It's not, I think what Thomas Carlyle said the best. He's like, it's not what I have, but what I do is my kingdom. You know what I mean?
Right.
So when we step to it, it's like, I got every possession I could ever ask for. I dated every woman I could ever fantasize about. And then once you get to that place, it's like, man, what is life truly about? What am I going to leave here? And that's when you feel like, man, I'd rather do. I mean, money, you can always get money. Time, you can never get that back. Yeah. So I want to invest as much time into my community, into my people as I possibly can, just to be able to leave and establish that true legacy. You know what I mean? Whether it's into my own children or to the communities that, you know, we live in. So that's really my goal in a real way. And I feel like there's a lot of people who came before me who've done that, whether it's like Harry Belafonte, even Bill Cosby, even, you know, like, these are people who like created for us and opened doors that allow all of us to become millionaires.
And I believe it comes with maturity.
Yeah, real talk.
Yeah,
real talk.
It comes with maturity.
I think a lot of it, and then when you, because I mean, a lot of it, we be on our bullshit, so we see it. You know what I mean? Like, when we throwing thousands in the strip club and stuff, we know we could be putting this money to other stuff, but you gotta do that. It's all about balance.
Right.
It's like, to me, I kind of do stuff in the world. Like, my goal, my vision is to one day have my own children's hospital. You know what I mean? And I go to Children's Hospital monthly. I'm on the board of St. Mary's. I'm on the board of the Children's Miracle Network, just to always kind of keep that path going, because when it's all said and done, that puts everything in a proper perspective for you. You know what I mean? When you see everything that those little angels go through that they didn't ask for, but they doing it with a smile, it's like, that's what life is truly about. So that's the type of world that helps create my balance. So you don't catch me in a strip club, I'll be at the Children's Hospital. It's one or the other. I'm on one or the other place.
Balance at its best. Hey, Nick, it's been a pleasure. The turban.
Yeah.
Can we talk about that?
Absolutely, man. It's really, it's funny. Like, it started as a spiritual quest. It still is. But then, you know, pop culture turned it into more of a fashion statement, which I'm all about the fashion, so I'm not mad at it. But ultimately, man, it represents my sovereignty. And then and everything. And people always say, well, what does sovereignty mean? Like, is it a Moorish thing? Is it a Sikh mm-hmm. thing? It's kind of all of that together, because truly what sovereignty is to be self-governed and to be self-governed by your own inner power and peace. So to be able to wear the turban, like, with people, I like when people talk about it, you know what I mean? Like, whether they making jokes about it mm-hmm. or whether they actually understand what it is and respect it, because ultimately it happened when turbans were first created, or Death Stars or whatever you want to call them.
Right.
It was about safety. The person who had on the turban was the person in your community with the wisdom and the knowledge and even the person that you went, like, whether it was the authoritative figures and all of that stuff, they were the ones that, like, they were almost like the police, but the police that was policing the community the right way. You know what I mean?
Right.
So to be able to rock that, and then to see that society has changed it into the stereotypical negative thing, like, you're supposed to be scared of the person with the turban. So I was like, yo, if I can help create that conversation, whether someone thinks it's cultural appropriation or not, because it all came from Africa. So ultimately, I get to have these interesting conversations with the youth and people, and then I get to be different and stand out anyway, which is something I always represented as well. So I'm like, yo, I'm all for it. I'm never taking this thing off.
That's dope. So you're not a religious person, you're a spiritual person.
I'm a spiritual person, but I grew up in a religious household. I mean, my pops was a minister. I come from a long line of ministers.
What is it with minister kids that just break out and become like...
You know what it is? Because they always seeking. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, when you come, like, somebody to conduct a congregation, you live and watch your parents do that, and you watch them, like, that's something different. You know what I mean? Them PKs is crazy. They always say, like, the PKs is the worst kids ever, because they always got to prove something to be like, they ain't so goody-goody. But they also, like, to me, like, this entertainment thing, this energy, this soulfulness of music and touching and speaking to others is something that was in me. It's in my DNA. Like, I could never be a preacher because I sin too much.
Right.
But it's like, I still want to be able to guide and inspire, and that's kind of where it goes to. So, but definitely spiritually, like, I, you know, I was one of those kids that could and still can recite every verse in the Bible, but I was like, yo, it got to be some more to it. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
who says this? So then that's when I started studying the Quran and the Guru Granth Sahib and, you know, the ideas of Buddha and all of these type of things. It's like, just to just know more.
And
you
come
know
up with your own understanding.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Like, I feel like, yo, we're taught what to think and not taught how to think.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So, like, when you understand, like, it's all about how you think, and it's not about who's right and who's wrong, but we come under these monotheistic ideas that there only can be one way, and if not, you're damned. Like, that's kind of crazy.
Right.
But you know, not to get that deep on it, but it's like, yo, just explore, ask questions. I tell that to my kids all the time. Like, you can ask me any question in the world, I'm gonna give you a solid answer.
Well, that's what it was for me.
Yeah.
Because I just would constantly ask questions and not get answers, and then I was like, okay, well, you just teaching me to just believe this, but for what?
Yeah.
And then I started looking deeper and deeper.
Yeah, and
like,
there ain't nothing wrong with those belief systems, because when you actually understand, it all comes under the sun god where religion was originated. So we all come from the common nucleus of it, and everybody just had their own interpretation of it.
Yes, exactly.
You know what I mean? So it's like, I always think of it like phone service. You know what I mean? Like, some people got Verizon, some people got Sprint, some people, I got T-Mobile.
Right.
I know I'm going to get through, hopefully you get through. You know what I'm saying? Like,
all our calls drop at some point.
Yeah, exactly. It's whoever your phone carrier is. That's praise that person.
That's what's up. Listen, Nick Cannon, thank you so much for being so, you know, transparent.
Man, all the time. I appreciate the opportunity.
No, so do I, brother. I appreciate the opportunity and your time. New project coming out.
Yeah, that Only You is rocking right now. Model Music,
Model
Incredible
Music.
Gang. We out here. Nick Cannon, Ike, turn up.
I like that.
Let's get it.
That's what's up. I appreciate you, my brother.
No doubt. Peace, beloved.